Welcome this morning. Can you hear me all right? Yes? Okay. Good. Welcome this morning. For those of you that I haven't met, my name is Julie LeBrun, Reverend Julie LeBrun, and I'm here while Carl is on sabbatical, helping out. So we'll start with our welcome this morning. We'll start with announcements. And the clue to the announcements this morning is the aroma in the air. Can you smell the lasagna? I can. As soon as I walked in the door, I felt hungry. What's going on? So you're invited to attend the congregational lunch after worship. And as you know, it's lasagna. So we'll see you there. The welcome we extend in this church is as broad and as deep as we can make it. We welcome you. If this is your first time joining, or if this church is the place you call home, we welcome you if you're joining us from online. We welcome you wherever you are on life's journey, wherever you are on your spiritual journey. No matter how young or old you are, whatever your marital or economic status, your sexual orientation, your gender identity or expression, your ethnic or cultural heritage. We welcome those who consider themselves to be Christians, those who are a part of another faith tradition, those who are doubters and seekers, those that want to explore the mysteries of life and serve the ideals of compassion, of justice, and of peace. So you're welcome. Our land acknowledgement this morning. As people who seek justice and reconciliation, each time we gather in this place, we remember that this church is located on the unceded and ancestral territory of the Coast Salish peoples, in particular the Musqueam, the Squamish, and the Tsleil-Waututh nations. We pray that God will guide us in ways of reconciliation with Indigenous neighbors in our community and in our wider country. May it be so. Amen. Okay.
Good morning. Most of you know I'm Catherine Branch. I'm the chair of the Ministry and Personnel Committee, and Kristen Harkins is the chair of our council, and we have some very difficult news to share with you all. Some of you may have heard yesterday that Nancy had a family emergency. On Friday, as Brenda was driving home from Winnipeg, she died in a motor vehicle accident. We are all in shock and are absolutely devastated. Nancy and the boys are in shock and in grief and in pain. They are being cared for by close friends who have been communicating with us only as necessary. We know that you will all want to support Nancy and the boys. Kristen has arranged for flowers to be sent on behalf of council and on behalf of our congregation. Until we have heard otherwise, we ask that you send any cards, letters, or messages through the church office. Fuad has a basket ready for drop-offs, and then somebody will take these to Nancy periodically so she's not overwhelmed. Given the shock and the tragedy, we need to give Nancy and the boys space to process and time to grieve. On the M&P side of things, we are very, very fortunate to have Reverend Julie with us for support. Reverend Carla has also determined that her call is to be with us here at Mount Seymour in Nancy's absence while we try to process. She will be postponing her sabbatical and will fill in for Nancy for the foreseeable future. So for the time being, and for this week in particular, obviously all Nancy-led activities are postponed, in particular the commencement of Pilgrim's Path. Once we have had the ability to rearrange things and determine leadership, we will let you know. And as soon as we have any further information or further news from Nancy, we will pass it along to you as quickly as possible. Please hold each other close. Thank you.
Let us pray together. Gracious and loving God, we pray that this worship time can be a time of comfort as we are in shock at this news. We pray that this time together can be a balm, can be a bearing witness to life's deepest struggles, deepest pains and losses. We give thanks for this community. We give thanks for our spiritual practices that bring us together and call us to lean on each other. Call us to be together even when we don't know what to say or do. Call us to support each other when there's no answers or even questions. Loving God, be with us now as we worship. We listen for your healing spirit in words, in music, in reflection, in prayer. We listen for the healing comfort of the neighbor sitting beside us. Their very presence is a bearing witness to each of us together as we worship. In the name of Christ, we offer this prayer. Amen.
As you love.
Our theme today is Where Does It Hurt? And we didn't know what was going to be happening this Sunday. Sometimes we might forget to ask that question of others. Sometimes we might wish somebody asked us that question, rather than how are you, but where does it hurt? And of course, this needs to happen with people we can trust. People we can be vulnerable with. And sometimes we're good at that, and sometimes we feel we might fall short. And that's okay. So what I have for you today is just words of assurance. Family of faith, in the journey to love and care for one another, we are bound to make mistakes. Fortunately for us, we worship a God who shows us how to love. We follow the teachings of Jesus, who demonstrates how to be generous and giving. This teaching is extended, this grace is extended to us, even when we fall short or fail to do so with others. So here now, here today, hear and believe the good news of the gospel. You are seen. We are seen. You are forgiven. You are forgiven. We are heard. You are heard. You are set free. We are set free. Thanks be to God for this endless grace and love. Amen. I invite you now to share the peace of Christ with your neighbors, with a bow or a hug or a high five, whatever you're comfortable with. May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
You can share.
walking a path of love.
We are walking a path of love. We are walking a path of love. We are walking a path of love. Lead us home.
Today's reading is from 1 Samuel, verse 1 to 18. Sorry. There was a certain man of Ramathaim, a Zephite from hill country of Ephraim, whose name was Elkanah, son of Jeroham, son of Elihu, son of Tohu, son of Zuph, an Ephraimite. He had two wives. The name of one was Hannah. The name of the other, Peninnah. Peninnah had children, but Hannah had no children. Now this man used to go up year by year from his town to worship and to sacrifice to the Lord of hosts at Shiloh, where the two sons of Eli, Hophni and Phinehas, were priests of the Lord. On the day when Elkanah sacrificed, he would give portions to his wife, Peninnah, and to all her sons and daughters. But to Hannah he gave a double portion because he loved her, though the Lord had closed her womb. Her rival used to provoke her severely to irritate her because the Lord had closed her womb. So it went on year by year. As often as she went up to the house of the Lord, she used to provoke her. Therefore Hannah wept and would not eat. Her husband, Elkanah, said to her, "Hannah, why do you weep? Why do you not eat? Why is your heart sad? Am I not more to you than 10 sons?" After they had eaten and drunk at Shiloh, Hannah rose and presented herself before the Lord. Now Eli, the priest, was sitting on the seat beside the doorpost of the temple of the Lord. She was deeply distressed and prayed to the Lord and wept bitterly. She made this vow, "O Lord of hosts, if only you will look on the misery of your servant and remember me, and not forget your servant, but will give to your servant a male child, then I will set before him you as a Nazirite until the day of his death. He shall drink neither wine nor intoxicants, and no razor shall touch his head." As she continued praying before the Lord, Eli observed her month. Hannah was praying silently, only her lips moved, but her voice was not heard. Therefore Eli thought she was drunk. So Eli said to her, "How long will you make a drunken spectacle of yourself? Put away your wine." But Hannah answered, "No, my Lord, I am a woman deeply troubled. I have drunk neither wine nor strong drink, but I have been pouring out my soul before the Lord. Do not regard your servant as a worthless woman, for I have been speaking out of my great anxiety and vexation all this time." Then Eli answered, "Go in peace. The God of Israel grant the petition you have made to him." And she said, "Let your servant find favor in your sight, Then the woman went to her quarters, ate and drank with her husband, and her countenance was sad no longer. This is the word of God's people. Thanks be to God.
For our reflection today, because the topic was where does it hurt, we had planned this, and I think maybe we need it more than ever today. So we're going to, Tierney's going to lead us in a short meditation, is that the right word? Kind of a grounding exercise. So like a grounding prayer or a grounding exercise. So I'm going to come and sit with Tierney, and it's just going to be a couple of minutes. That is part of our reflection time. So before we start, I'm just going to say a prayer for us. So as we begin this reflection time, I pray, loving God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of each of our hearts and minds be touched by your loving spirit. Be touched by your witnessing spirit. May it be so. Amen.
Good morning, church. Well, I had no idea last Sunday when I agreed to do this what was about to unfold this week. So I still think it's a good idea. We were talking about where does it hurt, and we are a hurting people today, no question about it. First of all, I want to give you all permission to practice self-compassion more than ever and to shed tears as you need to. There is no shame in that. Tears are welcome. And that is why God created us with these tiny little holes in the corners of our eyes so that the pressure can be released, the tears can come out, and the feelings can come out. It's interesting that in Samuel today we heard about someone weeping because there are going to be many more tears to be shed. So I'd like to invite you right now to just, if you feel comfortable, softly close your eyes, if that feels safe. And if not, just keep them softly open with a gaze somewhere in front of you or upward or down on the floor, and just let your eyes be relaxed. I'm going to invite you to ask yourself to take a couple of deep breaths as best you can. As it turns out, oxygen is the best natural medicine that we can give our cells and every tissue in our body. So don't forget to breathe. If that's the only thing you remember to do in your grief, keep breathing. Just take a moment to see if you can ask yourself to just settle yourself down a little bit. And in the words of Desiderata, be gentle with yourself beyond a wholesome discipline. Self-compassion is key. Sometimes it's hard to put the feelings to words. Sometimes we don't even know what the feelings are that we're feeling. There can be so many of them all at once, and it can feel overwhelming. When it is difficult to put those feelings into words and to find the words for them, sometimes it helps to just take a moment to scan your body from head to toe. The body is very wise, and it will give you messages about how you're feeling that you may not be able to articulate. So I'm going to invite you right now, without any judgment, to just take a moment to notice what you're feeling in your body, starting at the crown of your head and working down and doing a scan. top of your head, down through your forehead, down through the front of your face, your cheeks, nose, mouth, your chin, down the side of your head and the back of your head, your ears, your neck, front and back. To continue on, just scanning your shoulders, your chest at the front, your back, down your arms, down through your hands to the tips of your fingers. Back to the chest, down through your stomach, down through your lower abdomen, your hips, your behind, thighs, front and back, down through your knees, your shins and your calves, down through your ankles, through your feet, to the tips of your toes. And just notice if you're feeling any sensations anywhere in your body. It could be heat, pain, heaviness, maybe a lightness, numbness, tingling, itching. Just take a moment to ask your body, what are the sensations, what are the messages that it is bringing to you about something you might be feeling? And notice if there's an area in your body that's feeling some discomfort or something unusual. Ask yourself if you can just breathe some love to that place. To just take in a little bit of a deeper breath and breathe light and love and compassion and warmth to that area. And just give it some extra compassion right now. And see if there are some emotions that come up through the body sensations, some feelings that maybe you weren't connecting with. And it all matters, and it all counts, and it is all valid, and it is all absolutely acceptable. So without judgment, just take a moment to love yourself. And I'm going to invite you to ask yourself to take another deep breath or two. And just let go of whatever you're feeling right now. And I want to do one more exercise. If your eyes are closed, just gently let them open with a soft gaze. Just come back to where you are here and now. Always remembering to stay in the present, because that's all we really have is now. I'm going to ask you to do one more quick exercise. I'm going to ask you, with your permission, to raise your right arm in the air and give it a good stretch. If you feel comfortable doing it, just a good stretch. And bring it across to your left shoulder. Do the same with your left arm. Raise it up in the air and have a good stretch and bring it across to your right shoulder. There. You're giving yourself a hug. God bless you. I'm glad we're all here together today. God bless.
Thank you, Tierney. Maybe that's a new experience for you. Maybe that's something that works for you, and maybe it doesn't, and that's okay. We're trying a few things to help us today. What to say on a morning like this? A poem came to mind for me by William Blake. Maybe you know it. Joy and woe are woven fine. Joy and woe are woven fine, a clothing for the soul divine. Under every grief and pine runs a joy with silken twine. The more we love someone or something, the more it hurts when we lose them or we lose it. Joy and woe are woven fine. could be a person that we love, could have been a hope or a dream that we loved. But I'm talking about the things that are deep within us that we love, things that are part of our core value and core being. That's where we get our joy, right? But that's where we get our woe as well. They are woven together. We've had this news today of something awful happening. Brenda dying suddenly, unexpectedly, tragically. And sometimes, maybe you've heard this, when something like this happens, somebody says, "Oh, it's in God's plan." No. I'm going to disagree with that. Or you might hear, "God doesn't give us more than we can handle." I'm going to say no to that too. I think these remarks can be quite dismissive. It's just not that easy. God isn't that simple, and neither are we. Neither are we in our hearts where this joy and woe resides. But God is in it when these awful things happen, when we're in deep grief. That is where God meets us, is in that deep place. Down in the well, that's where the Spirit finds us and pulls us up or comes down with us, right? God is with us in the deepest pain, in the deepest struggle. We have to open our hearts a bit, and it hurts and it's hard, and I don't like it either. But that's where God meets us, is in those places. And I think our spiritual tradition and our practices and our faith is deeper and richer than those kind of remarks that dismiss something quite easily. And I think the story today with Hannah helps us a bit with that, gives us some clues. It gives us some clues to bearing witness, to sharing in pain and grief with another person, so that something new, healing, new life can somehow, in the darkness, break through. Because that is what happens. Maybe not today, when you get the news, but that is what happens. And I'm sure some of you have experienced that in your lives. So Hannah is troubled. She's sad, she's grieving, she's anxious. The text even tells us she's not eating. So we know she's upset. She's upset because has not been able to have a baby. If that's your experience, I don't want to re-traumatize you, but that's what's going on in this story. She's upset because she's not able to have a baby. And what we do with this story is and say, okay, maybe that's not our pain, maybe it is, but we have other pains in our lives, and we're experiencing one this morning with this sudden loss. You know, we have pains and losses in our life, loss of a job, loss of a loved one, loss of health or changes in health, trouble with mental health, serious mental health, and addiction. You know, these are the things that pain us. Looking at climate crisis, looking at war, there's no shortage of things that pain us. So we share that with Hannah, right? We have that in common with her. So what does Hannah do? Well, she's kind of being brushed off and ignored and not treated very well by her family and community. And one day, she's praying to God. The text says she's moving her lips, but no words are coming out. So she's praying to God. By herself. And Eli sees her praying. And do you remember what he says? Do you remember? You're drunk. Can you imagine? She's praying. She's distraught. And he says, you're drunk. That could have ended the conversation right there, right? That could be the end of it. But it's not. Hannah has courage, and she speaks up, and she says, no, I'm not drunk. I haven't been drinking at all. That takes guts. Here she is, distraught with grief and pain, and she says, no, you're wrong. That's not what's happening. So there again, the conversation could have ended right there, but it doesn't. Eli suspends his judgment. He suspends his assessment of the situation, and he listens. He stops, and he listens. And he listens like no one else has listened to Hannah before. He was able to say, where does it hurt? And she was able to tell him. Both these things take so much courage. And it would have been so easy for this conversation not to happen, but it did happen because of they persisted. And what happens is, it's not about whether Hannah has a baby or not, but she experiences a change, healing. Somehow, something shifts in her. The text says her face looks no longer sad, is what it says. Something's happened in her through this act of listening, through Eli bearing witness and sitting with her. Something shifts. Something deep inside her shifts, where she doesn't feel the sadness the same. Wow, that's the depth of our spiritual tradition. That's what can happen when we bear witness. And again, it's not about changing her circumstances. We can't undo things that happen, right? We can't undo when someone has died. We can't undo a medical diagnosis. But something can change. We can move through it in time and with support and with somebody bearing witness to what has happened. Maybe in the story we're Hannah. Maybe we're the person who needs someone to sit with us and bear witness. Maybe in the story we're Eli. Maybe we're that person who can listen to the neighbor across the fence or listen to somebody at church in coffee or listen to a family member. Maybe sometimes we're Hannah and sometimes we are Eli, both. This isn't about either or. Our humanness, our spirituality is so encompassing, we can be both, you know, at different times in our life. But this bearing witness, this sitting with, is a balm for the wound. The situation doesn't change, but something shifts in Hannah. And she's no longer deeply sad at that time. Now, I realize this isn't a one-time event. We get that in the Bible, you know. 1, 2, 3, fixed. These things take time. But this is how it works. The bearing witness, the sitting with, the being with. Knowing the situation doesn't change, but we can be transformed and healed by God through this act of witnessing. And I give thanks for faith communities because we are about witnessing, bearing witness. And I know I'm learning Mount Seymour even has a program for people that want mental health counseling and can't afford it. I mean, that is bearing witness in a big way. And of course, ministers and leaders in the church are always open and available. We're listening, always. So that's what our tradition gives us today, bearing witness. What a huge gift. What a huge gift. But, and it took effort, right? Eli and Hannah could have walked away a few times in that conversation. Bearing witness does take effort, and we know today it hurts to bear witness to another's pain. Bearing witness can take us by surprise. Eli and Hannah didn't know that was happening that day. It was pre-Google Calendar, yet it happened. We didn't know what was going to happen today in church. I didn't know what was going to happen today in church. I still don't know what's going to happen today in church. It's happening. Bearing witness takes us by surprise. So withhold your judgments of yourself and others. Speak your truth. And be a vessel. Speak your truth, and also be a vessel for God's healing. And listen and be awakened by God's grace. Listen and be awakened by God's grace. Today and in the days ahead. May it be so. Amen.
We're going to pray again together. Holy God, I know that you hear our prayers. You are the God of hospital rooms and graveside services. You are the God who felt a touch in a crowd. You are the God who sees and knows all pain, infertility and illness, loneliness, despair, tragedy, and death. You are the God of the hurt and the healing. And I know that you hear us today. So with open hearts and open palms, gracious God, we come to you with our joy, and especially today with our pain. We give you thanks for all the blessings in our lives, for the strength of community, for the love and support we experience in this place. We give thanks for this beautiful land we call home. We give thanks for our families and for our friends and for all that connects us. We have so much to be thankful for, and we know that you are part of all of that. And yet, in that same breath, we also carry pain. Like Hannah in the temple who brought you her prayer, we desperately need your ears, your grace, your healing touch. So today, we lift up to you all the hurt and the pain that we carry. Grief is so much deeper when we know great love. We have lost a dear friend in Brenda. We pray for Nancy and for Nathan and Joel. We pray for Brenda's mother, for her brother, and for her many, many dear friends and colleagues. We ask that you hold them close and give them the strength to face each difficult day and to reach out for what they need. We pray for ourselves, for our grief, for our broken hearts, and for our feelings of helplessness. Help us to support each other well through our pain. Holy God, we know that you are listening. We know that you are here. For you are the God of hospital rooms and graveside services. Be among us. Hold our hurt. Heal our wounds. Draw us closer to one another and closer to you. With the hope of people who dream, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And as one of the ways that we reach out to others in their pain, in our community and beyond and in the world, we collect the offering today that we then share beyond our own doors.
Into this week, bearing witness to other people's lives, to their joy and to their woe. Step into this week knowing others, Eli is out there waiting to bear witness with you, your joys and your woes. Go with the love of God, the teachings of Jesus, and the power of the Holy Spirit. Go in peace, today and always. Amen. Amen.